Very warm welcome to Titi Angela, member of our Institute for Research in the Humanities, and for the first time, our guest at the seminar in Intelligence Science, not last time. And the title of the talk today is on some recent ambiguities of the concept of group selection in philosophical biology. Again, you have the floor.
Thank you for inviting me here. And before I begin, I'd like to say a few words of introduction about what this paper is about. It writes in an area I've been working on for quite some time, especially on a particular debate I've been working on for quite a long time, probably too long. So, but it will be over soon, I hope, a couple of months or so. This is it's not even work in progress what I'm presenting here. It's more like live working, if you will, because I think it's the fourth version of this paper I've been toying with for the past month. So this is like, there's absolutely no distance between, I didn't have the time to take some distance from it and to let it rest for a while and then look at it again to see if it holds together or not. And that's really how you get the most blatant errors possible. So I hope there will be none here, but if there are any, I hope you will point them to me. And the second thing would be, I like to think of every paper as having a sort of a literary structure, as following some pattern from sort of a literary story. And this one will be a sort of atypical in the sense that the pattern will be more like Edgar Allan Poe's Tales of Ratiocination, in which basically the suspense is killed by midway through the story, and then you're simply witnessing a narrator who explains you how the mystery was solved, and that's about it. This is pretty much the strategy I would have here. There will be a long introduction for people to see what the problem is about. Then once the distinction at the middle that kills the suspense, and then some exemplification as to why those distinctions matter. Why they help us clarify some ambiguities, at least in this issue, in this debate. And the last point I want to make is that that central distinctions that I make are at least one connection that I make in that particular place is somewhat dishonest, in the sense that I did not include here one strong argument against a particular connection that I make. I didn't do it because it would have been too complicated to discuss, and mostly because it would have been too long. So if maybe it will come up during the discussion afterwards. So I'm prepared to talk about it. I just didn't include it here, so I can explain orally a bit what that is about. Alright, so the aims of the paper is to decompose a particular debate in multi-level selection theory into bite-sized pieces. The guiding idea is that as long as we fail to recognize that the debate is made up of a number of separate issues, we cannot solve it, and it only gets increasingly confused as people propose new and new arguments for or against different positions, and everything gets mixed up because the separate issues are not isolated. So the consequence of this guiding idea is that I do not propose a solution here. I only intend to divide the whole issue, the whole problem, into some separate issues that can be individually solved. So the point, I will begin with a long introduction. For those of you who've seen something similar from me, and excuse me, but it's well, I have to try to make the problem comprehensible for everyone. So a little background information on group selection. It's an idea that is as old as the theory of natural selection itself. And Darwin, in the first edition of The Origin of Species, spoke about this explicitly when in a passage where he discusses some difficulties of his theory. He says, "I will not enter here on these several cases, but will confine myself to one special difficulty which at first appeared to me inseparable and actually fatal to my whole theory. I allude to the neuters or sterile females in insect communities. For these neuters often differ widely in instinct and in structure from both the males and fertile females, and yet from being sterile they cannot propagate their kind." So the problem for Darwin was, if there is a struggle for existence, how come some organisms give up reproduction altogether? And that was the least of his problems. The biggest problem was, how come these sterile workers get increasingly adapted to their tasks if they do not reproduce? So if the mechanism of natural selection does not work on them, because since they do not reproduce, you cannot say that the pattern works as the offspring of initial workers and so on and so forth. So he goes on to say, this is by far the most special difficulty which my theory has encountered. And he finally proposes the solution by saying, this difficulty, though appearing inseparable, is lessened, or as I believe, disappears when it is remembered that selection may be applied to the family as well as to the individual, and may thus gain the desired end. So his idea was very ingenious, that natural selection does not work only on organisms, but also on the hives, for example, or on an entire family of bees. So the one hive that has more, say, a better division of labor can be fitter than one hive that has a lesser division of labor, so that in which female workers also reproduce sometimes or very often, or with respect to the cases where they never reproduce and just put all their energy into working. So that's one way of looking at the idea. Obviously, in the meantime, things have somewhat changed with respect to insect communities especially. Though they have, I would think that they have not changed entirely. Nowadays, we would mostly explain this by what, since Hamilton and John Maynard Smith, we would call kin selection. But things are a bit more complicated, because what I'm going to talk about here is two ways of seeing, of conceiving of group selection. But it has been shown pretty recently, and actually it has been shown a number of times for the past 30 years or so, that kin selection and one way of looking at group selection are mathematically equivalent. So basically, when I say nowadays we would explain this by kin selection, mathematically one could read this as, nowadays one could explain this as group selection, as Darwin does, but understood in one of the two ways I will talk about here. So things have changed since Darwin, but not that much. So another introductory point is that Darwin's idea can be understood in two different ways, and this is a distinction, a sort of classic distinction in multi-level selection theory between what's called MLS1 and MLS2. So in MLS1 you get two groups with a different degree of division of labor, say, and one the group with a higher division of labor produces more offspring, so it grows more than another group. So the idea here is that, for example, if the two groups are attacked by some predators, the one that is bigger is probably potentially more able to defend itself than the other. So that will have evolutionary consequences. But that could also be read in a different way. So that could
the same thing, but the variation in the degree of division of labor could lead to some other consequence, for example, to the group with a higher division of labor producing more offspring groups and not more offspring individuals than the one with a lower division of labor level. So, and this is known as MLS2. So MLS2, in MLS2, the fitness of a group is defined as the number of offspring groups that group produces. And in MLS1, it is defined as the number of offspring individuals that that group produces. In this paper, I will only deal with MLS1, so with this one, which is what the debate I talk about here is about. The whole issue in MLS1 is one of the guiding, one of the main engines of discussing MLS1 is the evolution of altruism, how altruistic traits could have evolved. And usually it is, in order to explain this, one appeals to MLS1 sort of scenarios, which involve a population that's composed of several individual types. Usually there's altruistic ones and selfish ones. So and furthermore, there are two minimal conditions that need to be fulfilled in order for group selection to occur. And that is that the population is divided into several subunits or groups that vary in the proportion of types that they contain. One group contains more altruists than the other one, for example. And B, the group character of each of these subunits influences the absolute fitnesses of its members. For example, if the altruistic individuals are clumped more in one group, then the altruistic acts that they produce will tend to increase the fitness of the other members of their group, and that will happen more than in the other group containing less altruistic individuals, for example. So this is the sort of example I will use from now on. Only I will talk about in order to make things more a bit easier to follow. I will speak of altruists as producing a particular substance that is beneficial for the group. So say think of something like tadpoles in a puddle, and then one tadpole, which is an altruist, produces a substance that clears the water of harmful bacteria, for example. So that's the sort of altruistic behavior I'm thinking about. And it's altruistic because not only because it does good deeds for the others, but because the individual producing that thing, that substance, pays the cost for that production. Everything is paid for it. So that's usually what is assumed in any case. Another thing that needs to be kept in mind is that in this sort of situations, and in this sort of MLS1 cases, there is a necessity for periodic group reunification for us to be able to say that group selection is in play. That's why initially, in the modern era, say, of group selection theory, since D.S. Wilson, say, 1975, approximately, this sort of scenarios mainly refer to animals that have that are living together for a particular part of their life cycle. For example, bird chicks that inhabit the same nest and then before spreading out at maturity, or insects in the larval stage that spend their time on the same plant together and then disperse or situations of this type. Okay, I'll take the classic example, which is exactly from D.S. Wilson, just as an exemplification that I will use here. So there are two groups of the same size, sized 100 each. This group contains 20% altruists, this one 80%. All right, so there's a fitness sort of scheme that
we can use in order to calculate the fitnesses of individuals. So there's a base fitness for each individual, the fitness that it gets simply for being an organism of that particular species, say, in that particular environment. Say. And the altruists pay a cost for producing the antibacterial substance I was talking about, and then they receive the benefit of the antibacterial substance produced by the altruist neighbors that are in their group. So for example, if there are 20 altruists here, one altruist will receive the benefit from 19 other altruists, except himself, because he doesn't help himself. Let's assume in this particular case. The same thing goes for selfish types. There's a base fitness that's the same as that of the altruists. They don't pay a cost because they don't produce the substance. And they benefit from the substance released in the environment by 20 altruists this time, and not just 19, because they have 20 altruist neighbors. So we set the figures that the cost is 1, the benefit of produced by 1 altruist for the entire group is 5. And when we apply that, we get the following thing. So the fitnesses are these ones in group 1. So 996 for the altruists, 1101 for the selfish types. Which means that in the second group, 1299 for the altruists, 1404 for the selfish types. Which means that in both groups, the altruists are at a disadvantage, so their frequency drops from 0.2 to 0.184, and it drops here from 0.8 to 0.787. But the amusing thing is that in the global population, it is the altruists that actually increase. So they go up from 0.5 to 0.516. So how we will explain this is, we're going to get to that later. There are two ways of explaining, of looking at this result. But I will specify two further assumptions just to clarify my language here. I will assume that the individual trait is one. So I will give numeric values. We need that for the calculations later. And we need to assign numeric values to the individual trait, which means that we arbitrarily say that being an altruist means that you have a one value of individual character. Being a selfish type, you have a zero value of individual character, which makes sense in this case because we're not talking about body height, for example, in which the differences will be, I don't know, something like 175 and 170, for example. Whereas here, the difference is to have or not to have a particular trait. So it makes sense to call them 1 and 0. So this will help us establish the following equality between the group character and the proportion of altruists that they contain. So a group's character is the average individual character of the members of that group. So in this case, since the selfish ones are zero, in this group there are 80 selfish ones and 20 altruists, so the proportion of altruists is equal to the group character, and the same is for the second group. So the group character of the second group is equal to the proportion of altruists, which is 0.8. All right, so now for the two ways of understanding what happens in this case. The first one is known as the Price approach, and it's due to some equations by George Price 40 something years ago. According to this understanding, what happens in this scenario is the following thing. So in group one, we have the altruists are the red ones, the selfish ones are the blue ones. In group one, we have 20 altruists and 80 selfish types. There is individual selection within that group, in the sense that the altruists pay a cost that the selfish types don't. And this leads to the fact that the chunk of the piece of the pizza of this group that belongs to the altruist gets smaller, whereas the piece that belongs to the selfish types gets bigger. So this means that there is individual selection in this group, and there is also individual selection in the other group. This, again, because the selfish, the altruists pay a cost and the selfish don't, there is individual selection, which means that again the piece of the pie for the selfish ones increases, whereas for the selfish one increases and for the altruist decreases. But how come the altruists increase then if they decrease in frequency within each group? Well, it's because this group containing more altruists grows larger than this group. So basically, when we add the two pieces of pizza of the altruists and the selfish types respectively, we see that overall it is the altruists that are at an advantage because of the difference in size of the two groups. So they begin as equal, but they grow at different sizes. So if I remember correctly, this group produces 1,080 individuals overall, and this one 1,320. And that difference in size, coupled with the fact that the fitter group contains more altruists than the other one, so the altruists are better represented in the fitter group, explains that even though they decrease within each group, they increase over the entire population. So this allows the price approach to calculate, to sort of isolate the contributions of individual selection and of group selection in such a, in a scenario of this type. And it's done with the help of this equation. It's not very, the equation is not very important in itself. The idea is that we calculate the change in individual character that happens within each of the two groups. So basically, we calculate this. It's as simple as that. The drop from 0.2 to the drop to 0.184, and the drop from 0.8 to the drop to 0. From 0.8 to 0.787. So we calculate that and we make the average of the two versions, the average theory, and we get the component that is allegedly the result of individual, of the action of individual selection. And on the other side, we have group selection, which is we make basically the same thing. We calculate the change in the proportion of altruists that is brought about by the fact that one group outgrows the other. So we basically do the same operation that we did for individuals within a group, but we do it for the two groups here, assuming that they belong to one population. Just like the individuals here belong to one group, these two are considered to belong to one population of groups, as Elliot Sober says. So that's one way of looking at things. The other way is to understand called the contextual approach. It's a multiple regression, an application of multiple regression to multiple selection. And it consists in decomposing the fitness of each individual of the case according to this equation. So what I've tried to draw what this means here. So we get what's called the intercept. So that's the fitness of one individual of this population. Of one individual we can pick at random, but then we're going to have to do that for every individual of the population. So his fitness is going to be determined by the intercept, which is the base fitness, the fitness that everyone has irrespective of the group it is in or of the type it is of. So whether it's an altruist or a selfish type, he always gets the same base fitness. As you can see, the blue things are equal. Then let's jump to this one because it's easier. So there's more antibacterial substance in the second group than in the first. So the one individual, irrespective of type, whether it's an altruist or a selfish type, will be helped by 0.2 units of substance in group 1 and by 0.8 units of substance in group 2. So basically this means that whether you're in group 1 or in group 2, this value is going to change. So this is going to be 0.2 or 0.8 depending on the group you're in, but it will not depend on the type you are. So whether you're an altruist or not, this value remains the same. So this is why I the sort of brownish things are equal here, because this is a selfish type in group 2, it's an altruist type in group 2. And are equal here because this is in group 1. And then this is a bit more complicated because of the case itself, because this calculates the effects of the individual character on fitness, so individual character being whether you're an altruist or not. But the point, the problem here is that this brings a cost and not a benefit. So it's a negative value, the beta 1 is a negative value, which means that instead I should have represented it for the altruists here, but actually it's the selfish ones that benefit from it. So because it's negative, so it should have been reduced from this, from the altruists, but it's better, it's easier to represent it as a positive gain for the selfish types. Well, it's not so very important. But the point is that we decompose the fitness of each individual of that population according to that, and we determine, the idea is to determine the values of the partial regression coefficients before we move on. But what happens then? So we divided the fitness of all the individuals in three layers. And then we put them all together, and we make a sort of a cake. In the sense that we imagine that the total fitness of the metapopulation is divided into these three layers determined by the base fitness, the individual character, and the group character. So this is all the 2,400 individuals that the two groups produce together in this case. So we're going to have 2,000 individuals that is output due to the base fitness, which is here. We're going to get -1,005, which is the output due to the cost paid for the production of the substance. Again, this is a negative value, but I had to represent it somehow, so it's there. And we're going to have 505 individuals, which is the output due to the effects of the antibacterial substance. So the beneficial effects of the antibacterial substance produce 5,005 individuals in this in the two groups put together. So the idea is we have to calculate the change in the proportion of altruists, right? So if the cake, the three-layered cake, is divided equally between altruists and selfish types, then there's no change. So to calculate the change, you see to what extent the cake is not divided equally. So any departure from the mean means that there is change. So, and you calculate it exactly like that, as the departure from the mean. So in this particular case, the base fitness is the same for all the individuals, irrespective of type, so that is equally shared. But the cost paid, the fitness effects of the cost paid is not equally shared, obviously, because only the selfish type, the altruists, pay that cost. Whereas the benefits of the produced by the antibacterial substance, again, are not equally shared, because if we look at it, the altruists are basically clumped together mostly in one group. So there are 80 altruists in one group, which means that the benefits of the substance, of the antibacterial substance, tend to be preferentially thrown upon other altruists. So altruists tend to help themselves because there are 80 of them in one group, and only 20 selfish types in that particular group. So the total evolutionary change, the delta z in this scenario, will thus be given by the extent to which the two types do not get equal shares of the fitness effects of each of these two factors. So I don't know whether that was clear enough or not, but the idea is that we no longer think of selection as acting within groups on one side and between the two groups on the other side. We think of selection as acting at the same time on the entire population, so both individual and group selection act at the same time in the metapopulation, and this is what I tried to represent with this three-layered cake. All right, so mathematically we do this this thing by calculating the beta 1 first with the help of the equation that I talked about earlier, and multiplying with the variance in individual character and group character, and we divide that with the average fitness within the population. Less important. Okay, so the beta I will be dealing with here. It's basically about which of the two ways of conceiving of MLS1 group selection is preferable. This is sort of the actual how should I say that? It's kind of a soft debate in biology, in the sense that the biologists that have used the contextual approach have, for example, explained why they do not use the price approach, because it has a particular drawback. So, but it was no real debate. So it's a philosopher, Samuel Rokasha, that turned it into a debate actually about 10 years ago or so. And there were some biologists that tried to downplay the importance of this debate by trying to say that actually there is no problem here, they can both be used, and there's no reason to make this turn this into a debate. But I think I'm not going to talk about this here, but those attempts to downplay the issue I think are wrong, even though they come from very important biologists. But I think they're totally wrong, because they try to frame their refutation of the debate in single level terms precisely, and not in two level terms or multi level terms, and that's really what this is all about. So, but anyway, when I say that the debate is about which way is preferable, I'm not merely talking about the pragmatic question, because the authors that are involved here in this debate actually talk about one approach being correct and the other one being incorrect. So I've given some examples here. Eugene Earnshaw saying contextual analysis offers the correct account of MLS1 group selection. Samir Rokasha saying that both approaches are correct statistical decomposition, but only one can be a correct causal decomposition, and he favors the contextual approach as well. Whereas Edwin Sober, who favors the price approach, while he's more nuanced, say, but basically that we can hold him to saying something about correctness. In the sense that he's openly endorsing realism about the units of selection, but by the latter he means the idea that selection may not act only among organisms but among groups. So, and he defines that as variation in fitness among groups. So that this year he explicitly, in a paper, he explicitly states, my definitions of group selection and individual selection are compatible with the price approach but not with the contextual approach. And if we combine these things together, we're probably entitled to infer that expressing realism about the notion of group selection that's not compatible with the other means that we claim basically that one is correct and the other one is incorrect. I think that's pretty sound reason, I hope. Anyway. So my strategy will be that of isolating a few separate issues, and then showing why the isolation of these issues helps us avoid two kinds of confusion. So I think we need to distinguish between a number of factors here. So one of them is the notions of group selection that correspond to each approach. So pretty much what I've tried to present above, but very briefly, according to the price approach, group selection is defined as the variation in the fitness of groups that is due to their variation in character. So one group outgrowing the other because of the group characters that it has. So because of having 0.8 altruists within it, one is fitter than the other. So according to the contextual approach, group selection is defined as variation in the fitness of individual types that is due to variation in group character, or correlatively, that is due to the non-uniform distribution of types into groups. So I will give an example later in the next slide, so it will become clearer a bit. So one notion refers to the variation in fitness of in the fitness of groups. The other one to the variation in the fitness of individuals, of individual types, more precisely. So the two definitions refer to different putative processes because they refer to different agents that are being selected. So we should note that if the authors involved speak of definitions as being correct, then these definitions are not taken as merely stipulative, but ostensive in a particular manner. More precisely, that I think it that if a supporter of the price approach claims that if such a thing as group selection exists, it should be conceived of along the lines of the price approach notion. So what I'm trying to say is that you don't to take part in this debate, you don't necessarily have to be a realist about group selection. So you can say, okay, I'm not sure whether such a thing exists, but I think that if it exists, it should be conceived of this in this manner. So I think you can take part in this debate by assuming a position of this type. As we saw, Sober does not do that. Sober says, I'm a realist, and I'm a realist about that particular assumption. So, it's not necessary to go that far. So, but my point is that we're dealing with putative processes here. So if they exist, they should be conceived of that, but we're talking about processes and about the way we should conceive them. Before we get to the particular example I want to add something that is that no amount of additional information can help us settle the issue. So, for example, if we look at the example I gave above, so it is obvious what the causal dependencies are. The altruist produces a substance, pay a cost for that, and the substance helps everyone in the group except the altruist that produces. That's all that we need to know causally about the case. There's nothing more to know. It's a hypothetical case. So how we should settle which process actually takes place there is not a matter that can be helped by adding any empirical information about that particular case. So it's a completely theoretical issue. And my point is that it needs to be solved in a coherentist manner. So we need to decide which one fits better into our view of evolutionary theory. It's not an empirical problem that can be solved by looking for additional information. That's the point that I'm trying to make. So there are two points. We're talking about processes here, even though they are putative. And the issue cannot be solved empirically. There's a second issue. So that was the notion, the idea of the notions of or the definitions of group selections viewed of group selection viewed as putative processes. The second thing that we need to distinguish is how to measure the effects of group selection. So that the effects on the change in the population of in the population mean of the focal trait. In my case, in my example above, how do we explain, how do we measure the effects of group selection on the change in the proportion of altruists in our case? And the point is fairly simple here. If one wants to measure the effects of group selections in the sense of the price approach, we do so by calculating this, which is the component the price approach gives us for that. If one wants to measure the effects of group selection in the contextual approach sense, we do so by calculating this, which is the component that the contextual approach gives for that. That's all we need. It's not much more complicated than that. So I'll just give, without entering into the mathematics of this, which are a bit complicated, I will give an example to make it easier to understand. So, imagine there's a case in which we have exploiters, which are individuals that decrease the fitness of each member of their group with one unit, And by doing so, they increase their own fitness by 10 units. All right, so again, base fitness is arbitrarily set at 10. We again have two groups. In one, there's one exploiter and four non-exploiters. And in the other one, there are four exploiters and just one non-exploiter. So we calculate the fitnesses of each type in the group. So the exploiter here will get 10 base, which is a base fitness, plus 10 because he exploits the others, for a total of 20. But one non-exploiter from here will get 10, which is the base fitness, and he loses one because he's exploited. So the fitness, total fitness is 9. So in the group, the entire group will have a fitness of 20 from the exploiter, and 4 times 9 from the non-exploiters, for a total of 56. So what happens in the other group where there are more exploiters? One exploiter's fitness will be 10, which is the base fitness, minus 3 because he is also being exploited by these 3 individuals. So minus 3, plus 10 because he does his own exploiting of the other individuals. So the total for one exploiter is 17. And for the lone non-exploiter here, it's 10, the base fitness, minus 4 because he's being exploited by 4 exploiters. So the total is 6. The group total will be 4 times 17 plus 6, which is 74. Now, as you can see, the group containing more exploiters grows larger than the group containing less exploiters. Right? So that's pretty much like how humans work. The higher the competition, the greater the productivity, I imagine. I don't know. Anyway, the idea is that the two approaches, each of the two approaches asks a different question of this case. So the FICE approach asks, given their composition, which group is fitter? And the answer is the group containing more exploiters. Therefore, the FICE approach will detect group selection favoring the exploiters. So because they are better represented in the fitter group, exploiting is favored by group selection. The contextual approach will ask another question. Are the exploiters favored or disfavored by the fact that most of them are clumped together? So most of them are in a single group. And the answer is they are disfavored because in this way they mostly exploit each other instead of exploiting the non-exploiters. Hence, the contextual approach will detect group selection working against the exploiters. So that's an example supporting my claim that to the question, how do we measure the effects of the two putative processes that I've been talking about, we simply apply the components offered by the two approaches. And this is the right way of measuring each of the two putative processes. So, the point is that on the choice of our notion of group selection depends how we calculate the effects of that putative process. And vice versa, by choosing one measuring method, we are implicitly choosing one putative process at whose effects we're aiming at by our measurement. It may seem trivial, but we'll see later on that it has it is useful, this trivial statement. Okay, the third point that needs to be distinguished from the other two are the claims about the accuracy of our measurement in particular cases. So one can claim that the component offered by the price approach is the right way of measuring group selection sensed to the price approach, but still one can be reserved about claiming that in any given particular situation, the result we get is an accurate measurement of the effects of that putative process. And that is because the value of this covariance may be affected by unknown or ignored factors. That's what biologists always say, and statisticians in general, correlation is not causation, so we should not infer causation from correlation. Why do they say that? Because when you do a correlation, you don't know what's underlying that the result of that correlation. So, but the point I want to make is that the fact that one must be reserved about the accuracy of one's measurement in no way counteracts the fact that this mathematical component is the right way of measuring the effects of that putative process. So, one is a theoretical problem and the other one is an empirical one because when we do a covariance, we don't know whether we have all the data or not. That's pretty much, in a, at least in empirical cases, but that it also happens in hypothetical theoretical cases in which you set, you do not rig the fitness function so as to fit your model, which is what I basically did about my example. So, about this third point is I'd like to note that it is a separate, decoupled issues from the two above, while the two above are logically connected. As I said, on the putative process we choose depends our right way of measuring it and vice versa, so the two are logically coupled, whereas this third element is decoupled from the other two. It has, on the choice of our right method of measuring a putative process, does not depend the accuracy of our method. It's a different issue altogether because it's empirical. So ignoring these relationships only confuses the debate discussed here. And in what follows, I will simply give two examples of such confusions. One of them belongs to Elliot Sobol, which is the example of the failure to recognize that the notions of group selections, the notion of the two putative processes, and the issue of the right way of measuring them are connected. So Sobol, who supports the price approach, makes a distinction between several types of questions we can ask in multivariate selection. And I will only talk about two here. So there's a qualitative question that we might ask. Is individual selection occurring? Is group selection occurring in this particular case? And then there's a quantitative question. How much of the total change in that population is due to natural selection at the individual level, and how much of it is due to selection at group level? So he then states that he supports a form of qualitative realism based on the fact that when groups are defined by fitness interactions, the price and contextual approach almost always agree about the qualitative facts. And he thinks that this agreement, this apparent agreement between the two approaches, so basically what he says is that in most cases when we're looking at a case and we're trying the price approach and then we're trying the contextual approach, they will both say, yes, group selection is occurring here. So that's basically what he said. And then he tries to say that is an argument, can be used as an argument in favor of realism about group selection, in the sense that we can claim that group selection is a process taking place in nature because of this consensus between the two approaches in most situations. The exception will be, I will talk about it a bit later. But on the other hand, he says that if the two approaches rarely yield the same results with respect to the numerical values of the effects of individual and group selection on the change in the population mean of the focal trait, we can be quantitative conventionalists. That is, we have good reasons to claim that there is no fact of the matter as to how to partition these effects of the individual and group selection in any given scenario. So, basically, what Sober is saying is that the only difference between the two approaches is how they measure group selection and not how they conceive of group selection. So basically, he fails to see that there's a connection between the two. An example can be, imagine we have a series of numbers, and we have one way of calculating the mean of those numbers and one way of calculating the mode of those numbers. And by some weird circumstance, both the mean and the mode are called the middle of the series, right? So basically, he claims that if both our methods indicate that there is a mean and there is a mode, we can be realists about the existence of a middle of the series. Obviously, that's a weird thing to say, because what you have to decide is what you need. Do you need the mean or do you need the mode for the explanatory purpose at hand? Saying that the middle of the series exists has no explanatory purpose whatsoever, serves no purpose whatsoever. So the idea is that if you want to be a realist about group selection, you have to be
to choose one approach or the other in order to say which putative process you are realist about. Because that's choosing one way or the other of measuring, it actually means choosing one process or the other. So there would be a sort of reply, but I don't need to get into that. Because it's not very important and I don't want to be too long. So a second example is a combination of two sort of errors. It's of the same failure that Sober made to recognize that the notions of group selection and the issue of the right way of measuring them are logically connected, and it's connected with a different error, the failure to recognize that these two issues are decoupled from the third issue of the accuracy of our measurement in particular. So this depends on explaining what the almost in Sober's quotation about means. It referred to soft selection cases. So let's take another example with the exploiters. Again, they decrease the fitness of each member of their group with 1 unit, and by doing so, they increase their own fitness by only 4 units this time. Base fitness is again set at 10. So again, we have 1 exploiter and 4 non-exploiters in the first group. The fitness is 10 plus 4 because he gets 4 due to his exploiting. That's 14. And the fitness of the non-exploiters will be 10 minus 1 because each one of them is exploited. So that's a total of 9. So for each non-exploiter, the group total will be 14 plus 4 times 9, which is 50. And then what happens in the group containing 4 exploiters, 1 non-exploiter? 1 exploiter will be 10 minus 3 because it's exploited, plus 4 because it exploits, top for a total of 11, and non-exploiter 10 minus 4, which is 6. So the group total will be 4 times 11 plus 6, which is again 50. So the two groups will be equal. So there's not one group outgrowing the other, even though the composition of the groups affects their fitnesses. So 1 exploiter has 14 and only 11 here, 1 non-exploiter has 9 here and 6 here. So that means that the group character affects the fitnesses of individuals but does not affect the fitnesses of groups. So this is what soft selection cases usually are. There are more complicated situations, but usually we refer to that. So the failure to recognize that the notions of group selections and the issue of the right way of measuring them are logically connected consists in claiming that soft selection cases pose a problem for the contextual approach. That's the position defended by Samir Okocha. So at some point, now he's a bit more ambiguous about it as of late, but without expressing serious doubts about his previous position. So I guess it's going to change soon for him, but we'll see. The price approach will detect no group selection in a case like that one, because groups do not vary in fitness. So both groups have an output of 50, so the price approach will say there's no group selection, there's only individual selection. The contextual approach will again detect group selection against the exploiters, because again, being clumped in one group, they tend to exploit each other more than they exploit the other time. So this is tantamount. So basically, when Okocha thinks, wait a minute, there's a problem for the contextual approach because it detects group selection in situations in which groups do not vary in fitness. So basically, when Okocha thinks this is a problem, it is tantamount to asking from the contextual approach to detect group selection in the sense of the price approach. So, which is obviously something that it cannot do. To give you an example, it's pretty much like trying to measure the weight of something by using liters as units of measurement. So obviously that might work. So in the case of water, we might get the same numerical value in liters as in kilograms. But that's only by accident. Liters are simply not meant to measure weight, and vice versa. Kilograms are not meant to measure volumes. So this is what Okocha asks of the contextual approach. He says, because the contextual approach detects
group selection in cases where there's no group fitness variation. This is a problem for the contextual approach, but it's all a problem only if one thinks of group selection in terms of the price approach and not the contextual approach. So basically, he's failing to recognize that the two issues of the putative process and the correct way of measuring it are logically connected. But there's one way of trying to avoid that problem, and I have to thank Adrian Curry for raising it when he read the previous version of the text of the paper. So there's a possible reply that actually falls into the other error that I've indicated above. And it consists in countering and claiming that the two notions of group selection that I've talked about are actually mere approximations of another, more general notions of group selection that we are still lacking. So basically, this is how we could read the following quotation from Samir Okaj, who says, the tension between the price and contextual approaches arises because there are two requirements that pre-theoretically we would like to satisfy in order for there to be selection at the collective level. The first requirement is a collective character, a collective effect, so group effect, on particle fitness. So the group character affects individual fitnesses. That's what that means, that requirement. The second requirement is varies in collective fitness, so varies in group fitness, in my terms. As the soft selection example shows, where this requirement is not satisfied, we are reluctant to acknowledge collective level selection, group level selection, since the real-time conditions are not satisfied. The price approach and the price and contextual approach each satisfy one of these requirements, but not the other. So basically, the soft selection case, the requirement of variance in collective fitness, he says, is not satisfied by the contextual approach, and this one is not satisfied by the price approach, the requirement of collective effect on particle fitness. What does he mean by that? Let's take an example with two types. There are greens and browns. Greens have a fitness of 10 irrespective of the group they're in, while browns have a fitness of 5 irrespective of the group they're in. So in a group with one green, two browns, we have a total of 10 plus 2 times 5, that's 20. In a group with two greens and one brown, we have a total output of 2 times 10 plus 5, which is 25. So this group grows larger than this, even though the group character does not affect the fitness of the individuals in any way. If we apply the price approach straightforward into this case, it will detect group selection here because one group, this one, will be fitter than the other, and it contains more G's, so we could say that the group character varies. And so even though the group composition doesn't affect the fitness of individuals, the price approach will say group selection happens. So this first requirement that Okasha is talking about, the requirement of group effects of the fitnesses of their members, indicates that in order for us to be able to say that there is group selection, it is not enough that one group be simply fitter than the other. It must also be the case that that difference between the fitnesses of groups is due to the difference in group character. In other words, it must also be the case that the group character has a causal influence on the fitnesses of the individuals of that group. But remember that this is exactly the price approach notion of group selection, namely variation in the fitness of groups that is due to the variation in character, that is caused by the variation in group character. So the definition of the putative process that supports the price approach frame satisfies both of Okasha's requirements very well. So both the necessity that groups vary in fitness and the necessity that group character be a causal factor for the fitnesses of the members of that group. So trying to say that the two notions of group selections are mere approximations of a more general notion that we are still lacking, paradoxically leads us to claim that the more general notion is actually the price approach itself when it is viewed as a putative process and not as a method that a simple mathematical thing that we apply to something, to a given set of individuals. So what's wrong? I think Okasha confounds two separate issues. On one side, the notions of group selection themselves, or what I call the putative processes themselves, and how we may prove that the causal claims that are embedded in those notions are actually true or plausible in particular cases. So if I apply the equation of the price approach to the case above, involving green and brown individuals, I will detect group selection where there is none. But that doesn't invalidate the notion itself of the price approach. It only says that I've applied it wrongly. I've applied it to the bad case because I failed at disentangling the causal dependencies of that particular case. So it only proves that mathematics can do everything, which is something no one contests. So what I meant by this second example is that if we isolate these two issues, we're going to see that there are two sides to the debate discussed here. On one side is what should we call group selection given the general principles of our theory of evolution? That is, which of the two notions best fits in the framework of our evolutionary theory? And the second one is how do we determine whether and to what extent the causal claims embedded in the two notions of group selection are justified in particular scenarios? And for which one are these causal claims easier to prove? This is probably more important than the first. The first question is has a fundamental ring to it because it concerns the structure of evolutionary theory. The second one is more pragmatic, and it explains, I think, why in recent years experimental biologists, as Goodnight recently pointed out, have used only the contextual approaches and have tended to avoid the question. So that's pretty much what I had. Sorry if that was too long.
Questions?
So,
how do you get into this? The exploited case has got me kind of going more pluralist again, where I'm starting to think that these are just different ways, these are answering two different questions. So let me try and explain. We have this mathematical phenomena that we think is realized in some biological populations. The mathematical phenomena is sometimes you have individuals with traits whose relative fitness is lower than the other individuals in their group, which nonetheless increase in proportion over generations. That's the phenomenon. By the price approach, you say, group fitness varies depending on the composition of the group. On the contextual approach, you say individual fitness varies depending on what group you're in. Right. Now, here are two questions. Imagine I'm a betting man. And betting, as in I'm putting money on who's going to do well. Right? And imagine someone comes to me and they say, and this is in the exploiter case specifically, and someone comes to me and they say, all right, you're going to bet on a group. What group do you want to bet on? I'm going to say, I'm going to bet on the group with the most exploiters in it. Right? That's the kind of thing that you're going to say. If you're answering that question, then it seems like the price approach is giving you the right explanation. So you say, why the one with the most exploiters? Ah, well, the group with the most exploiters in it is going to be the fittest. Now imagine someone comes to you and says, right, I want in this circumstance you to bet on the fittest individual. Which one are you going to bet on? Well, I'm going to bet on the exploiter in the other group, right? Because he's the fittest individual, right? And then I should use the contextual approach, because the contextual approach is dividing my individuals. I mean, one way of thinking about the contextual approach is that it's giving you four types instead of two types, sort of, right?
Yeah.
And so if I'm asking, in these scenarios where individual fitness varies depending on group membership, if I'm interested in, well, who's the fittest individual here, it seems that the context approach is giving me the right sort of answer. If I'm trying to bet on which group should I bet on, then the price approach is kind of giving me the right sort of answer. Now, what I'm not sure on is how this line of thought is supposed to play into the attributing blame to group selection or not. But here's a stab at it. It might be something like this. When I'm in a contextual approach frame of mind, I'm asking, how does group membership affect the individual fate of each? It's answering correctly that question, right? And so when I'm measuring group selection, I'm measuring the effect of group membership on an individual's fate, right? Now, of course, that can then get summed up to mathematically get the same answer. And the price approach, I want to know groups, the sort of the effect of composition on a group, so I'm interested in the group's fate. Yeah. And so it strikes me that these are just two different questions, right? One question is about the fate of an individual, given that their fitness varies depending on groups, right? Whereas the other question is about the fate of, in some sense, the fate of groups, or at least maybe the fate of proportions or something like that. And that's, I mean, so that's, if something like that's right, then it looks like we're describing two different processes. Insofar as they're sort of two different questions, and it seems like these give two different legitimate explanations to these questions.
Yeah, I agree and disagree.
Excellent.
So, with respect to the first part, that's one of the most astonishing successes of group selection theory. It's the egg production in hens. I don't know if you're familiar with it. There was this guy in the 90s that thought about how should we increase the egg production in hens, in artificial farms. So in farms in general. But you know, they were kept in industrial-like containers. Was not bio agriculture. So his solution was not usually what one would do in that particular situation. What one did until him was to select the hens that produced the most eggs. So they selected those more productive hens and they put them together in one container, hoping that would increase productivity, which it never did. So this guy thought, why don't I try to take one group that produces some more eggs than the others, but only slightly, and reproduce that, and of the resulting groups, I take the most productive one and reproduce that, and so on and so forth. So in the space of, I don't remember exactly, 6 years, I think, he increased the productivity by 150%, something like that. Simply because, the idea is that hens are aggressive, so they fight when they're put in the same container, the same space, and that stress that results from excessive fighting inhibits egg production. So. By taking the most productive hens, selecting them, they were selecting the most aggressive hens, actually. And when they put them together, the whole thing repeated itself. So they fought against themselves. Some of them won, and the other ones got inhibited in their egg production. So they got the same productivity as before. Whereas when they selected for groups, they actually selected for the most more pacifist group. So, and then they among the offspring groups of that group, they selected the more pacifist again, and again, and again. So they basically selected four groups, and for peaceful hens, but the peaceful hens were selected indirectly via this group selection. So that's to answer the first part of the question. For the second one, I might think you're right, but actually it doesn't work for two reasons. Why is this not the same question? I think it's for one thing it's because even though we ask different questions of things, those different questions are applied to the same say explanatory goal. For example, if I'm going to try to explain how warning calls evolved in monkeys, right? So this is another example frequently used for, you know, the monkey that sees a leopard will call out to her group neighbors, and that draws the attention of the leopard to herself. But still, she still does it, so she doesn't play it safe by hiding and not saying anything. So, how does this sort of behavior evolved. So you might say that, well, we have two different ways of explaining it. All right, but the problem is that mathematically they're not identical. And this can be explained in the following manner. So basically there's a type of the contextual approach that's called the neighbor approach, that's easier to use, which says that, which basically defines individual selection in a case such as this one. It defines it as what happens when groups are formed randomly, right? So basically we can imagine that if these groups continuously regroup, reform, regroup, reform, each individual will, in the long run, will, each type, for example, will in the long run benefit from the same sort of neighbors as the other. So in the long run, the E's will be in a group with, I don't know, 2.5 N's, and the N's will be in a group with 2.5 N's as well, and the same for the other one. So, so random distribution defines a situation in which there is no group selection, there's no individual selection, because there's no variation in the distribution of these two groups. So in the long run, you will think random means no group selection, because so group selection will only be if there is some other factor that tilts the group composition, that makes them tend to clump together. And usually one involves kin selection for that, so a kin relationship. So this is the idea is that random distribution and individual selection are connected, and that basically means no group selection, right? Unless a supplementary factor comes in. But for the price approach, things are not like that, because when you assume random distribution, what does that mean? It doesn't mean that all your groups are going to contain 0.5 exploiters, 0.5, so 50% exploiters. It means that many of the groups will be around the 50% mark, but some of them will be skewed, will be at 80%, 20%. So any sort of departure from the mean is going to mean group selection. Whereas in the other case, randomness, irrespective whether it means departure from the mean or not, was equated with no group selection.
By the context approach, it is.
Yeah, by the neighbor approach, actually, to be more precise. But then it's a variation of the contextual approach that varies only very slightly with the choice of variables. But it's better to give that example because, well, it's complicated why. But the idea is that it's easier to. So the point is that they in the long run.
Sorry, let me just interrupt. I'm not seeing how randomness. There must be something I'm missing, because I'm not seeing how randomizing the groups or group membership is going to. It's still going to be the case that your individual fitness varies depending what group you're in, whether they are randomly assigned.
Yeah, but in the long run, you can assume that whether you're an E or an N, you're going to have the same neighbors, right? So that means that if you equate random distribution with individual selection, that means that basically you're going to say, unless there's an additional factor that tends to preferentially clump the E's with the E's and the N's with the N's, this trait has evolved by individual selection, Whereas the price approach sees every departure from the mean, which is the random distribution, normally conceived, so it does involve a departure from the mean, we see it as potential group selection. So that the same trait, whether you use one approach or the other, the same trait will evolve either by individual selection or potentially, not necessarily, by group selection. So the idea is that even though they are two different questions, they can reach get to completely
results with respect to the long-term evolution of truth. Is that, and the other point is that, well, which is really what it derives from this one, is that actually, if we look only at the definition of group selection, we might think that the two are basically two ways of looking at the same thing, and there's nothing substantive going on in there. So the distinction between them is epistemological only, but it does not make too much of a difference. But that is because we're looking at the wrong place. So the right way of I think of solving the problem is by looking at what we call individual selection, which is what I just did in the random distribution. You know?
Okay.
So
I realized when you started talking that the two questions I gave us, which was what group should I bet on versus what individual should I bet on, those are two different questions given the question that you're actually trying to answer, which is how come we get altruism involved, or how come
we have
that group composition that we end up with. So that third question, the strategy I'm trying to run here is a strategy where we divide our contrast classes in terms of what our explanation is quite carefully. And it struck me that the point I was trying to make was that if I'm interested in which group is the fittest, it seems like the price is dividing things up the way I want. If I'm asking who's the fittest individual, it seems like the context is carving things up the way that I want. Now, my question is, how come I end up with the group composition that I do? They both answer the question the same way, don't they?
Well,
right, so here's the point, right? So here's where things, there might be some conflation, right? So I think you're right, these people are conflating. Maybe here's another possible conflation. There's the question, how come I end up with the group composition I have? Both the price and the context approach give the same answer to that. Right?
Yeah, which is basically no answer.
And then there's the question, what group's going to be the fittest? And then there's the question, which individual's going to be the fittest? Those are two different questions. The price carves things up in a way that tells me about the fitness of the composition affecting the group. The context approach carves things up in a way that tells me about how group membership fits with individual fitness. So with those two questions, I can see these coming apart. But the question, how does, say, altruism evolve? It's either or, it seems to me. It doesn't look like I have to make a decision in that case.
I think that's exactly where you have to make a decision. I mean, what I try to explain, but I should give a proper example and it would take too long, is that if you use one or the other, the conditions for the appearance of group selection are different. So basically, if you use one or the other, you're going to have to say altruism evolves in the long run because of some other factor and not group selection in the contextual approach framework, whereas in the other one there is the condition for group selection in the price approach is not correlative interactions are not a condition for group selection since the price approach, which means that you don't need a factor that would push, that would sort of tilt the way in which groups are formed. But in order for something to evolve by group selection according to the contextual approach, you need some other factor that would have to tilt this balance, that would have to say that that would clamp one individual's preferentially with their own kind.
So they give different definitions of group selection, that's right.
No, it's not that. They give different explanations of how altruism evolved because of that. So basically what I'm saying is that when you use the contextual approach,
altruism can only evolve by mediated by kin relationships, basically. So, because this is the main factor that ensures that one group contains mostly similar individuals, you know? Whereas when you use the price approach, kin relationships are not so important. Even random distribution can ensure the evolution of an altruistic trait. You understand?
Yeah, I get it.
So that's, I mean, it's an important issue. Say, but I mean, it's relatively important, but it's not. It's less important now that kin selection and contextual approach are proven to be mathematically identical. But it still remains important because if the price approach is right, as I think, then that's a big that's a blow to kin selection in general. So obviously, biologists would not agree in the least. But.
Move to have a beer together, maybe come up with more questions. Yes. Thank you so much.